Amen. Good to see everyone out this Good Friday. God bless you. Welcome to the house of the Lord. And good to see Tanya and Roger with us tonight. Amen. Violet and Lawrence with us tonight. God bless you. Amen. God is good. Amber, good to have Amber home. I know Mom and Dad is excited to have her home. And Brother Cecil. I don't know if this is the first time you've been back to church since your surgery or not. But anyways, I'm officially welcoming you. Okay? So let's give everybody a hand tonight. Yes, hallelujah. Let's stand and sing this hymn together. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing blood? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
In the blood of the Lamb.
Hallelujah. Remain standing tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Tom if he would open our service in prayer tonight. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, amen.
Hallelujah. Heavenly Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for another time, Lord, that you've given us together. Lord, that we might just lift up your wonderful name.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
And Lord, in this season, Lord, hallelujah. In this season, Lord, of your resurrection.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, we just come again together, Lord, that we might just give thanks, Lord, for the way that was made, Lord, through Calvary. Lord, by which you can, Lord, yes, we are saved tonight, Lord, through your precious blood. Father, we thank you for all you've done, Lord, in saving us and keeping us, Lord, down through the years. And Lord, as we gather together tonight, Lord, we just pray, Lord, that your presence, Lord, will fill the house tonight, Lord.
Yes,
praise Lord, that you would just pour out, Lord, of your spirit, Lord, upon, Lord, everything that's said and done tonight, oh God. Anoint our musicians, Lord, tonight, our singers.
Yes, Lord.
Anoint the pastor.
Thank you.
And Lord, just anoint everyone that's here tonight. Lord, that our voices, Lord, might touch heaven tonight. Hallelujah. That you might inhabit the praises, Lord, of your people once again. So, Lord, we give the service into your hands, Lord. Pray your blessing upon, oh God, each one tonight, Lord, that's here. And Father, do a great work, Lord, as we lift up your name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Amen. Stay standing tonight. We're going to sing another. If you can sit here if you need to, but let's remain standing and sing another hymn together. Found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley.
Glory to see in the blessed face where rivers.
Amen. That's good singing tonight. Praise the Lord. Amen.
But for the blood shed on
I'm
is my heart.
testimony tonight.
I remember waking up in the night time. Yes, discouraged, our broken. Had it not been for the aura of Jesus,
that again tonight. Hallelujah.
Yes, had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul.
Tonight and give me the help and strength to be able to come out to a service such as this and feel God's love and his presence. I just want to thank God tonight. One thing.
There's a story so unkind in the holy book we find, and it tells that Jesus stood alone one day. Accused and there condemned, yet there found no fault with him. The man who wore the scarlet purple robe, oh purple robe, my Savior wore. Oh, the shame for me bore as he stood alone, forsaken on the day. And they placed upon his head pierced the thorns and bloodstained red. His raiment was the scarlet purple. God's middle. He was mocked and scorned by all, and a tear of sorrow fell upon his cheek. Soldiers of the wicked man smote him with the evil hand. The man who wore the scarlet purple robe, oh, purple robe, my Savior wore. Oh, the shame for me he bore, as he stood alone, forsaken on that day. And they placed upon his head piercing thorns and bloodshed red. His raiment was the scarlet purple robe. Words I threw that they were played round the lips of Pilate gave. In this man I find no reason he should die. But the multitudes reply, let him now be crucified. Oh, the man who wore the purple scarlet robe. Oh, robe my Savior wore. Oh, the shame for me he bore, as he stood alone, forsaken on that day. And they placed upon his head piercing torch and bloodstained red. His raiment was the scarlet purple robe. Oh, purple robe my Savior wore. Oh, the shame for me he bore, as he stood alone, forsaken on that day. And they placed upon his head piercing thorns and bloodstained red. His crown was the scarlet purple robe.
Amen. I love you,
mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. As a father, I've known you as a friend.
life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
All my life, sing out. We're going to take a few moments in God's Word tonight before we share around the communion table. And I want us to open up our Bibles to Luke chapter 19, Luke's Gospel chapter 19. And this particular passage of Scripture is the account of Palm Sunday and as the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, and so we're going to look there for a few moments tonight. Before we do, let's pause and just give this time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the ministry of your Spirit in this place tonight. God, we have heard of testimony of, Lord, of answered prayer, and for that we just give you thanks and praise. We've also heard tonight of those that are going through storms and struggle, Lord, in their life. And Father, I just pray, oh God, that you would just continue, oh Lord, to just be with them, Lord. And I'm just reminded, Lord, of that scripture again. Lord, your mercy are new every morning. Your compassions, they fail not. Great is thy faithfulness. And so, Lord, we can just have confidence, Lord, that you will see us through the storms of life. Hallelujah. Lord, you don't always take it away, but, oh, Lord, you just walk with us through it, and you help us, oh, God, each and every day, each and every season. Lord, just be with your servant tonight. I pray for your anointing, oh, Lord, tonight as I share your word, and I pray, God, this would speak to some heart, and you would strengthen your church tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. And so I want to read this account tonight of how, you know, the crowds, they honored Jesus with praise, and they laid coats and laid branches on the path before him. And, you know, it encompasses, you know, the beginning of the last week as Jesus went to the cross. Luke chapter 19, beginning to read at verse 28. And it says, after Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And we know that from Matthew's account that this was a donkey. It wasn't a colt of a horse, but it was a colt of a donkey. And it was a donkey that's represented there, and that's what they went looking for. And so he said, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it, say the Lord needs it. And those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the donkey, its owner asked them, why are you untying the donkey? And they replied, the Lord needs it. Verse 35 says, they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the donkey and put Jesus on it. And he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down to down the Mount of Olives, the entire crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Verse 41, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment rather against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. May the Lord bless the reading of his word tonight. And so, as I said, what we're reading there is how the week leading up to the crucifixion, how that week started out. And we see as the week progressed and Monday came and Tuesday came, the disciples, well, they observe the ministry of Jesus. They see Jesus on this journey. And what do they see? Well, they see Jesus. They see him cleanse the temple, showing great zeal and love for his Father's house. They see Jesus curse a fig tree. You remember that story? And they see firsthand the power of the Lord's judgment. They observe a time of a connection and worship between a lady as she anoints Jesus with costly perfume, as she pours out an extravagant gift, and they see how it is so pleasing to our Lord. As this journey progresses, the disciples, they could also see Jesus as he began to face opposition in this last week and in this last, you could say, the last mile of the way. Something was beginning to stir. An opposition was beginning to escalate, and the heat, as it were, was beginning to rise. And they could no doubt sense that a challenge was coming, that difficult days were ahead of them, difficult hours. Later in the week, they experienced the intimacy of the Last Supper as they reclined around the supper of the Lord. They hung out together with Jesus, no doubt experienced his encouragement and just being in his presence and how awesome that was. They sang together. You know, I just think about, you know, just the sense of the Spirit in this place even tonight. You know, and you know, maybe it's akin to what they were experiencing as they spent those last days with Jesus. And no doubt they laughed together. You know, they were, you know, that you had that sense of family. And they prayed together. Jesus, you know, he shared with them openly and honestly about, you know, their devotion to him. And what happens next? We know that they end up in a place called Gethsemane. A time of struggle for Jesus. Jesus, knowing what was ahead of him, the great weight that he was called to bear, the strain of what he was about to do was so extreme. He's under so much pressure. The Bible says he sweat drops of blood. It speaks of such intensity. And he asks those closest to him, those that had shared in his presence, been in his, you know, that he communed with, that he'd been so close to, those that, you know, that experienced his touch, those that knew what it was to be, to experience his healing and his saving and just his power and his presence and what he brought to the room and what he brought, the atmosphere that he brought, what they were so privileged to take part in. Do you know we're privileged to take part in being in his presence tonight? Oh, praise God. And he asked them something. He asked them, those closest to him, he asked them to bear him up in prayer. He asked them to join with him in some way in what is going to be transpiring, to share just for a time in what was about to happen. And And our Lord, he had to experience in those moments, he had to experience a betrayal. And he's given over, and you know, Judas, the Bible says, betrayed him with kiss. You know, it's like somebody wrapping their arms around you, and they got a knife tucked up in their sleeve, and they're wrapping their arms around you, and they stab you in the back. You know, we see the disciples disperse when the situation begins to intensify, when they're called upon. And Jesus finds himself alone with his accusers, abandoned by those who had pledged their allegiance to him, you know, with so much conviction. You know, they worship like we worship tonight. But Jesus dies a criminal death alone, by himself. Isaiah 53:3 says he was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hid their faces. He was despised, and Isaiah said, and we held him in low esteem. Isn't it interesting when the pressure came on, when the opposition came, when the rubber hit the road, as it were, they rather than uphold him, rather than lean into him, rather than stand up for him, you know, they held him in low esteem. As if to say he's not even worth standing up for. Sad, isn't it? So Isaiah speaks of how Jesus was despised and rejected, suffered, experienced pain, and people hid their face from him, despising him and not thinking him enough or worthy that they might pledge their love for him. So we read in Luke 19, we read what started out as a week of triumphant celebration and festivity ended with challenge, struggle, and difficulty. Those closest to Jesus rejected him where they were nowhere to be found. And when the night came, when the last mile came, when the last stretch came, they were no longer walking with Jesus. And I feel this just to say to us tonight, you know, We're on the last mile of the way, church. That's right. You know, we're in a season where we're being called upon to stand for Jesus. Amen. We're in the last mile, and so when the night comes on the last mile of the journey, will you still be walking with Jesus? Will I still be with him? We see the last mile start out with excitement. Wow, look at all that Jesus is going or is able to do. Look at all that, that he's up to. And I can hear them saying, oh, I'm so glad to be a part of this. So glad to be a part of this church. So glad to be a part of what God is doing. It's exciting. It's lively. God is in the midst. But could it be that the hearts of his disciples, you know, were truly only revealed when the opposition came, when it was time to stand up for their Lord and Savior? And so tonight, what I want to do just for a few moments is I want to share some practical biblical advice from our text tonight on how we can guard ourselves in this day from disconnecting from Jesus as we journey the last mile. As we journey the last mile, how can we safeguard? How can we, look at this practically and understand, amen, the people that we're to be? And so I want to just give you a few points tonight. And I want you to just apply God's word to your heart. And the first is, be ready to go and to give. God uses people. God uses us. And we need to be prepared for that. As Jesus was beginning that last week, the last mile, as it were, he did something that was very unusual. He makes a stop on his journey to Jerusalem, a stop, you know, where he's going, excuse me. And he sends his disciples ahead of him to bring back a donkey. Isn't that right? That's what the Bible says. says, verse 30, it says, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you are untying it, say, the Lord needs it. And those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the donkey or the colt, its owner asked them, why are you untying the colt or the donkey? And they replied, the Lord needs it. Now, just to put this in perspective tonight, if Jesus was coming to Roddickton tonight, this story says that he stopped over in Plum Point somewhere on his way. And he sent his disciples ahead of him to come. And he tells them, go to Roddickton and go to Paul's house. That's a good Bible name. Go to Paul's house and Otwire's pickup, his new pickup, sticker still on the window. Isn't that what the Bible said? It had never been ridden on. And so they come, and so they're in the parking lot. They jimmy his lock. They get into his pickup truck, and they hotwire the pickup truck, and they're pulling out of the driveway. And Elaine says, Paul, somebody's stealing your truck. And Paul goes out, and he says, what are you doing with my truck? And they say, the Lord needs it. And Paul says, no problem. You see, Jesus, he sent the disciples on ahead. Amen. He sent them. He said, go. And then the next thing he required of Paul in this particular case was to give. And to be gracious, to abandon ourselves, to the work of the Lord and what Jesus' agenda is. Amen. Do you see that tonight? And you know something? Tonight, we're called to go, church, and we're called to give. Amen. That's a description, good description for the body of Christ. Amen. And so then we see Jesus send his disciples ahead. The next point I want to make tonight is that Jesus is always worthy of our worship. You need, and we need to be a worshiping people. We need to take every opportunity that we have to give him worship, amen, to give him glory, to give him honor, and not only in church, amen. Wherever we are, we need to lift up the name of Jesus. The Bible says that they brought, verse 35, they brought it to Jesus, the donkey that is, and they threw their cloaks on it and put Jesus on it. And as he went, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully praising God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. And they said, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And I want to tell you tonight, friend, keep giving praise to Jesus on the last mile of the way. Take every opportunity, amen. Fight through the desire just to sit back and take it easy. Fight the desire to allow other things to come on the throne of your heart, amen. Make sure that Jesus, amen, is getting all the praise and the glory and the honor that he deserves in your life. What did Jesus say? If you're not going to do it, the rocks will cry out. The third point I want to make tonight. There's always going to be somebody to criticize what's going on. There's always going to be somebody to criticize you. Verse 39 says, some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, rebuke your disciples. And Jesus said, and this is when he said, I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Now, what I want to tell you tonight, listen, there's always going to be critics. There's always going to be there's going to be somebody to throw water, amen, on the fire. I'm going to tell you that right now. Do you know that's true? And some folk mightn't even mean to do that, but others will mean to do it. We talked about that opposition the other Sunday. We preached out of Matthew chapter 10, didn't we? And we realize that that sort of thing is going to come. Amen. But I want to tell you tonight, you be a booster and not a knocker. I don't know if we ever sang that in Sunday school or not, or where that song came from. But be a booster, not a knocker. Amen. Boost one another up, and there's no place to knock one another down. Opposition will come, but I'm going to tell you something. You know, as we go to the last mile of the way, let's make sure that we're fearing God, not fearing man. Amen. Stand for the stuff. Amen. You'll not be sorry. You'll not be sorry. Amen. Fourth thing I want to share with you tonight, you know, as it relates to this last mile, is this. Get a vision for lost souls. Get a vision for lost souls. If you have a vision, keep a vision for lost souls. God weeps over lost souls. Verse 41 says, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if even you had only known on this day what would bring you peace. See, he was there, amen, and they didn't recognize him. And he says, but now it is hidden from your eyes. Do you know the Greek word here that is used is different than the words? There's two places in Scripture where Jesus wept. You know where the other one was? The other one was at the death of Lazarus, wasn't it? The shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. Well, this is the other place. But the Greek, if you look at the Greek, as I study this, you look at the Greek, and Jesus, you know, when he was at Lazarus' grave, you know, he was weeping. There was a tear rolling down his cheek. But the Greek here speaks of sobbing. It speaks of sobbing, an uncontrolled crying, a deep hurt within a heart that causes sobbing. And we see Jesus here that his emotions are so incredibly stirred that he actually sobs over lost souls, those that would not receive him. And I'm going to tell you something. This is what you want to hear as you come down the last mile of the way, as it were, in these days, even as opposition comes, you know, get a vision for lost souls. God still weeps over lost souls, and so should you and I. Amen. The last point tonight I want to make is made here in this text tonight. The very last part of this text tells them, you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. And as we approach, you know, or as we're on this last mile of the way, this journey, as it were, don't miss the time of God's coming to you. We sing that song sometimes, more than anything in this life, I want to make it. Amen. And I'm going to tell you something. Be in expectancy every single day for the coming of the Lord. The coming of the Lord is imminent. That means there's nothing else that needs to happen before Jesus comes back. He could come at any time. Amen. And just to give more impact to the last point as it relates to lost souls, Jesus said he hasn't come yet because he is patient and he wants more folk to come in. We're walking the last mile, folks. Jesus is coming soon. And I want you to hear me. Maybe you know, you've had a hard time tonight following this message, but I just want to give you just a summary tonight. Be gracious in all your dealings. Be ready to go and be ready to give. Jesus might just ask you for your donkey. That's right. Amen. Have a giving heart. Amen. Be willing to go. Amen. Be quick to obey the Lord's voice. Amen. Be active, you know, in what God is doing. You know, be engaged. Hallelujah. Understanding that all that you have, all that you are, belongs to Jesus. Amen. We forget that sometimes. And then, two, keep worshiping Jesus because he's worthy of our praise. Number three, fear God and not man. There's always going to be some critics. There's always going to be some skeptics in the crowd. There's always going to be somebody to give you some opposition. There's always going to be somebody to challenge you. Amen. Don't worry too much about it. Fear God, not man. Number four, maintain a love and a heart for the lost, for the unsaved. Amen. That's the heart of God. And the last point, be be ready for Jesus' return. Amen. I hope tonight, as I ask the question, are you saved tonight? I trust that each and every one of you can say with confidence, yes, I've asked Jesus into my heart. Amen. And my sins are forgiven. Have that assurance in him tonight. And so tonight, that's what I felt to share with you. You know, I feel with all my heart, you know, we're in an incredible time right now. You know, that there's things that are stirring. There's opposition to the word of God, the truths of God's word. The moral character of God's word is being challenged and many ways being defaced, you know, even within churches today. Amen. And we're the last mile of the way. Amen. And what kind of people ought we to be? That's right. And so, church, I just want to encourage you with that word tonight. Amen. There's nothing there that we can't do. There's nothing there that we can say, well, I can't live like that. We can live like that. Amen. By the help of the Lord and the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So I just encourage you with that word tonight. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Tennis to get ready with that course, Because He Lives.